Hello, I'm Lily Steiner, and I've always been high on life. I've always been a positive person. As a child, I'd get up on tabletops and sing with just the slightest encouragement. I always looked on the bright side of life and just expected everything to work out for me, and it did. Does that mean I experience no disillusion and tough times? No, of course not. I came out of Russia, and it was a long journey to a better life. And although I couldn't define it then, it was my attitude that kept me moving forward and kept my spirits high. I really believed everything and anything was possible. Lily High on Life has come out of a fascination about how and why people think the way they do and do the things that they do. I love talking to people, not just about what they've done in their lives, but more importantly about how they feel about their lives and the decisions they've made at different stages in their lives and what's made them who they are today and guided their choices. What are the things that guide you? What are the things that motivate you? What bothers you and what gives you joy? When you take responsibility for everything that happens in your own life, you can choose to change it rather than live on automatic pilot. You can get rid of the anger, you can get rid of the disappointment, and you can improve every single relationship you have in your life. Lily High on Life celebrates lives and the people who live them. Ordinary people who really are extraordinary when you get to know them. My hope is these insights into people you may not have known before make you realize your own strengths and self-worth and beauty. We all want to be loved and respected, just because we're human. As you go about your day, smile more, be a little kinder to everyone, and spread the love. And welcome to Lily High on Life, new editions for 2020. And I'm absolutely thrilled to have in the studio with us today, Warren Wills.
Lily, great to be here. I'm thrilled to be here. I'm actually very high on life. I wish I could say I was high on sleep, but high on life is a good place to be.
Well, I have to tell the audience that you are one of the most prolific composers, musicians, musical geniuses that I've come across. In fact, the word prolific needs to have a new definition with your name next to it, because not only are you writing, producing different shows, but you're doing it globally. Tell us, just touch on each of the different countries that you are right now today in 2020 producing and creating events for.
Well, I'm certainly happy to do that. I'm glad you use the word prolific, not OCD, because it's a very fine line between the two. I think my daughter and both myself, we're list obsessed. And once we make the list, we've got to go and do them. That's how it works. But 2020 is very exciting. And again, I've got to say quite honestly that I haven't sat down when I was younger and described or prescribed for myself a year where I must be doing work in the Middle East and in London, in America and in Kazakhstan and Eurasia. It's amazing how these things unfold. But where we are at the moment, there's the number of territories that I'm involved with for 2020. The first one, which is definitely sort of my main HQ and the hub of all activity, is London. And for me in London, it's been my home for 35 years. I've got three kids who have grown up there. I've got two grandkids there. But by its very nature, given its culture and its tradition, it really is the mecca, which we'll come on to, but in so many ways, of so much creativity. And I actually think more so than New York, because traditionally and culturally, so much of what goes right back, pre-Shakespeare even, emerged out of the UK.
London, and you've just completed a very successful sold-out show on the West End in London.
I was thrilled to be working on a production called Reputation. It was produced and written by Alec Glass, but I came in to do a lot of the heavy lifting, a lot of the composition, all the musical arrangements, and I directed and MD'd the show. We did have another Australian in it, a guy called Jeremy Seacombe, who was fabulous in it. The rest of the cast was UK. We did it at a Lloyd Webber theatre called The Other Palace, which is spitting distance from Buckingham Palace in Victoria. That's Victoria, UK. And it was fabulous. The reviews were great. The audience went out absolutely joyful. And the great thing about the show, it was set in the 1930s, and as a result, the music was very much what I call Fred Astaire, Ginger Rogers kind of musical. It was a feel-good show. There was no sex, there was no violence, there was no swearing, there was no murder. You don't get that.
And it was sold out.
It was sold out. It was great fun.
And then at the same time that you were doing that, you also went on this amazing tour of the Middle East as a Jewish boy from Melbourne. Please talk about that.
I am thrilled to say that about 10 years ago, I got a phone call from Sensible Studios, which is in Caledonian Road, near King's Cross in London, but it's an absolute state-of-the-art studio, and everyone from Michael Jackson, Sting, Elton John, Spice Girls, Kooks, everyone records there. And I got a call from them because my big thing is styles. That's my big shtick in music. I don't care what the music is, I celebrate styles. So if you said to me, Warren, can you play the theme from Casablanca in a Bavarian flamenco bluegrass and reggae style, I'd say, I'm your man, Lily. And that's what I do. So I got this call one night to go into Sensible Studios, and I thought, my God, what have I walked into? I walked into some kind of Al-Qaeda convention. What the hell is going on here? Anyway, long and short of it is they said, Mr. Wills, can you listen to this track and put some piano on it? I listened to the track. It certainly sounded like a very traditional Arabic piece of music. And it certainly sounded like a very complete one. So I thought, what the hell do they want me to do? So I did my thing and I played totally incongruous, incompatible my Warren Wills jazz all over the top of it, in my opinion, completely ruining the track. Anyway, no one threw knives at me. They did pay me. And 2 months later, I get a phone call. Mr. Wills El Tufa, which means the apple, is number one all over the Middle East, released on Virgin. It's number one everywhere. We need you immediately to come to Beirut, which at the time was where MTV and a lot of the big broadcasters moved from Cairo over to Beirut. So I thought, oh, this will be interesting. So I rock up to Beirut, and I actually went there twice in the same week to do two different floors of the main broadcasting thing for MTV. One was MTV Popular, one was MTV Classical. Then I went to Cairo, and we did the SOS Festival, which was like the Save Our Soul Festival. And then I was invited to go, wait for it, to Riyadh, which is quite interesting because under Sharia law in Saudi Arabia, music is illegal. So being asked as the token white male Western Jew to rock Riyadh was quite something. We had to perform at the French embassy, so we weren't officially on Saudi soil. We did three shows there and were promptly arrested and deported because we were about to go off to Jeddah. And they said, no, there's no embassies in Jeddah, which is on the west side of the country. So we were all flown off to Bahrain, which is preferable than being beheaded, which it goes on publicly on a Friday afternoon in the main square. So I was very happy to leave the place with my head still intact and on my shoulders.
We are too.
Well, absolutely. But then, after a little hiatus, I got a phone call when I was in London and Reputation, the show was on the West End. Ilham Al-Madfai is his name, is celebrating 55 years. It's a big anniversary in the business. Can you come and do a golf tour with us? Well, I said, the show doesn't actually finish until the end of November. They said, that's perfect. We can see if you can join us in December. So they flew me out to Dubai and Sharjah, and we did the Al-Majaz Amphitheatre, which is an absolute state-of-the-art 2,500-seat theatre. 20 musicians in the band, maybe two of them spoke English. I certainly don't speak Arabic. They gave me a song sheet in Arabic, song list. I said, that's no good to me, I don't read Arabic. They gave it in English. That was no good to me because I still don't know any of the songs that they're doing, but I have a very good ear. So, and they put the grand piano down the front of the stage, and it was a riot. It was absolutely fabulous and really humbling. And then I went back about a week later to Amman at the invitation of the Crown Prince of Jordan, and the gig was set up by King Abdullah. And it was great. We, again, it was about 20 of us, and all the musicians except for myself came from Egypt, Lebanon, Algeria, wherever around the Middle East. And they got a nice grand piano for me. I was down the front with Ilham. And we all stood up as they did the Jordanian national anthem to start the show. And then we went through it. He gave me some fabulous piano solos, like 10, 15 minutes, where he rambled on in Arabic, which I was very humbled by. I didn't understand. He looks at me at the end and he said, right, you're now an honorary Jordanian. And I thought, there can't be a lot of Australian white male Western Jewish pianists to get this particular honour bestowed upon them.
But did he actually introduced you as an Australian and a Jew?
Absolutely. And I was the last person on stage. And I don't know why this is a ludicrous story. I got a call in London. Do you have a gold or a silver jacket? And I thought, no, not really. I don't really do the Liberace unless I have to, you know. And they said, well, go and get one. So I ended up going to Angels and Shaftesbury Avenue to hire this outrageous Liberace-esque sequin silver jacket. And of course, we're in the changing room. I'm the only muggins putting this on. Everybody else is in traditional tuxes, and Ilham's not even. So I look like a mirror ball. So every time there's a lighting change, it's actually drawn on me. But nonetheless, everyone was very happy with it. We finished. Ilham is a, he's called the Beatle of Baghdad. He is that popular. He is the equivalent of the Beatles, if you like, in the Middle East. And when we finished the show, I asked him the first time, I said, why is there taped music and why are you playing? Why is everyone standing up? And it's the Iraqi national anthem that he closes the show with. And he had to flee because both he and his son, Muhammad, his son got into a lot of trouble when Uday Hussein, Saddam's son, was Minister of Sport. It's a whole other story, but long and short of it, they had to get out quick smart. They all did the run from Baghdad to Oman, where they're based now. So it was very touching and very moving. I'm waiting to hear back, would you believe, about March the 5th, going for one day to Doha in Qatar to do another gig with them, a royal gig with them. But can I share something which to
Please.
Me is really exciting? All of that is great, don't get me wrong, but I think it pales into insignificance in light of the next program or project that Ilham has invited me to do with him. He said to me while we were in Oman, he said, so Warren, have you heard of a writer, philosopher called Rumi? And I said, no, although I could make a joke about things being needing to be more roomy here and there, but I had never heard of him, R-U-M-I. Some of your listeners may well be familiar. You may well be familiar.
I am familiar.
You're way ahead of the game of me on that one, I'm afraid. But so anyway, so I Google searched Rumi, and apparently he was the most bought and the most read poet philosopher in the USA last year, despite being dead for 400 or 500 years. So he's a bit the kind of the Shakespeare Cervantes sort of time frame. So he was Persian, which, as you know, is a very niche language. And if you're not really in Iran, you're not speaking Persian. So Ilham says to me, listen, there's only two Persian writers who have made the grade internationally. One is Omar Khayyam, who I have heard of. And, of course, the other is Rumi. So he said, what he would like to do is get Rumi's best works translated into Arabic, which, of course, is spoken, half the world speaks Arabic these days. And in addition to which, as I said, it is interesting to note that irrespective of being spoken in Arabic or not, the fact is there's a massive appetite in the USA for Rumi. So nonetheless, he wants to do an East-West collaboration with me where the pair of us would compose an album of works taken from the Persian, translated into Arabic of Rumi. And that is coming up in April, which I'm really excited about, creatively doing a really nice hybrid East-West collaboration. And in fact, deeply honoured and humbled again to be invited to do so.
And incorporating it with the English as well would truly make it bridge building.
Absolutely.
Global bridge building.
Absolutely.
But I have to ask you, when you did this trip and you're up there even on the stage in these places, what is your internal voice saying to you as a boy who was born in Australia and very Jewish all of this? Are there conversations that pop into your mind?
The most bizarre experience I had was when I landed in Beirut the first time. Syria was still an occupying force there. And there were two ways you can go through. One is a thing, immigration for the locals, and one is for non-residents. I was the only one who got off the plane, so I got through rather quickly, obviously, but there's a massive queue of locals. I mean, at this time when I went, this is about 10 years ago, it was just before a guy called Harawi was blown up, if you remember. It was a big incident. They found him in his car on the fourth floor of a building in Beirut. So I get there, I am the only one, and there's a guy, a Syrian guy, wearing the Gestapo black trench coat. So the first thing he says to me, he says, huh, so you have been to Israel, yes? So I'm laughing very nervously. Oh God!
Because it's stamped in your passport.
No, it's not. My God, I wouldn't get through. I'd be arrested.
How did he know?
He was just being provocative. He was joking.
Oh!
But I very nervously laughed with him at the joke. Thought I'd better not say anything. The other thing, let me tell you, the other thing, which is where I had an unusual experience. When you arrive in any normal country where you are issued with a landing card when you're on the flight, they say, what's your name, what's your passport number, where have you come, where are you staying in this country, all the usual stuff. In Saudi Arabia, on the landing card, it has one question, what religion are you?
Wow.
Well, noting that they still have, as I say, Friday afternoon beheadings, I put not applicable. I thought that might be the smart move.
Especially going into Saudi Arabia.
Correct.
And then when you're actually there and you are the only Jewish person, does that have... what does it do to you on your... Is there fear? Is there pride? Is there wonder? What does it do to your soul?
Do you know what? I am genuinely grateful for the fact that doing music as I do, and I've said this, and this is my mantra for years and years, music genuinely transcends language, religion, politics and borders. I am not someone who has a political agenda either on the left, the centre or the right. I don't want to know about politics because by its very nature, politics is divisive. However you look at life or law. So to me, I'm going over there and music is the passport that I'm taking with me. Therefore, I find it really exciting that I'm given these opportunities which would otherwise be completely void. They would not exist. The doors would not be open for me. And even my lawyer, who is quite a prominent right-wing Jewish lawyer in London, he said, it's amazing, Warren. He said, what you're achieving with the connections that are being made artistically, these would be impossible to create politically. It's just not going to happen.
It really is just something that is so unique and special. And what I'm getting from your answers also is that you truly believe and feel that you know who you are and what you are, because you're not coming back to me with any, oh yes, you know, I only came from Australia. You have a complete sense of yourself as a total human in the world, mm-hmm. where you don't question. You know what you do, you know you do it well, and you are being constantly given appreciation by the world for what you're doing.
Believe me, I am also very, very grateful, and I mind it every day when I wake up how grateful, lucky and fortunate I am to have these opportunities. In any other walk of life, I wouldn't have these opportunities. But, unfortunately, to most people not involved with the arts, these doors are closed. But in order to maximize these opportunities, about 20 years ago, I got very involved in wearing a non-commercial hat, which I call socially inclusive music theatre.
Yes, we're going to talk about social inclusive theatre in a little while, but we haven't even been halfway around the world yet because we've just mentioned London and the Arab world, but you're also involved in Kazakhstan and in the Eastern European bloc.
Well, I love this story because I've got to be careful how I put this, because if I say Eastern Europe, I get my hand slapped, and if I say Asia, I get my hand slapped. But not so long ago, I was working quite extensively with a guy called John Farndon. John Farndon is currently the Royal Literary Fellow of Great Britain, and he is the most published author alive in the UK. He has 800 books published, not articles or essays, but books. And he's currently up for another award. He's up for the Penn Award for translations of works from Uzbekistan, and he goes to New York. And the Penn Award's a bit like the Oscars, but for translation. John got very heavily involved with translating works from Eurasia. So the first question we need to establish and ask is, what the hell is Eurasia? It is a very specific region of the world. As my friend Marat, who is, I'm not going to dare pronounce his surname, who is the roving ambassador of Eurasia, tells me, it is Russia, Moldavia, Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, Armenia, Azerbaijan. It's a very specific area. It has virtually zero profile in the West. I don't know, some of us might have heard of Baku because there's a Grand Prix running there, but on the whole, and I think Borat, Sacha Baron Cohen did a film about Kazakhstan, which was so derogatory, so ridiculous. Nonetheless, Kazakhstan is a very oil-rich country and is coming out of its dark ages of seclusion and isolation, and there is only one opera that is apparently huge in Kazakhstan. It's called Abai, A-B-A-I. Well, when I was in London, as one does, I got a phone call. Can I come in the next day to the Kazakh embassy in Pall Mall opposite the Canadian embassy? And I said, well, sure, why not? Why not? So in we rock and we meet the Kazakh cultural attaché, who says, now, I understand you boys are interested in doing this piece about Abai, but bringing it to the West, which means a reinvention of it. So it'd be new arrangements, it'd be a translation, etc., etc., to go on in London in June this year at what's called the Grimebourne Festival at the Arcola, which is in London. So we told them what we were doing, and we left, and 2 days later we get a call. We said, right, yes, The Kazakh government wants to produce it. They will pay for the whole thing. Can you put a budget together?
Whoa.
Well, we put a budget together there and then, which was wholly inadequate. And funnily enough, 2 days ago, we just submitted the full budget to them. I'm assuming that they said they're approved. Watch this space. I will tell you
how
if
exciting.
It goes on, because we need to start arranging, rebuilding, casting, etc., almost immediately.
So our special guest in the studio today is Warren Wills. You're listening to J Air 87.8 FM here in Melbourne.
This is your number one choice. Today's hottest hits.
Yesterday's favorites.
Yesterday's hits.
Today's hits.
Tomorrow's hits.
All hits.
All day.
Night.
Yeah, 87.8 FM.
And we're back with Warren Wills. So, Warren, with this new project as well, you are currently also involved in a World Children's Choir project.
Now, this is a big story. How much time have you got?
Well, we'll have to keep it down because there's still so much more. I wasn't joking when I used the word prolific.
Okay, I'll talk fast and I'll try and be concise. About 20 years ago, I was living in a borough called Haringey, North London. There are 200 languages spoken in Haringey, not only making it the most culturally diverse borough in England, but in Europe. And it's not always successful with the young people. There are a lot of gangs, there's a lot of fights, not dissimilar to some of the issues that certainly prevail here in the western suburbs. So I thought, listen, rather than walking around, we're all so clever, we're musicians and composers, we do West End, I thought, I'm going to put another hat on. This is my good causes hat. Why don't we do something for the youth of Haringey? And what is it that I do? Well, I put musicals on. So I thought, let's do a project whereby we take a bunch of kids deprived of opportunities to normally have, you know, access to these things. And why don't we do world premieres collaboratively of new musicals? So in 2000, the council in Haringey loved the idea. We will fund it. We will back it. We'll give you whatever you want. So every summer, which is August in London, I set up a company called Haringey Shed. Why is it called Shed? Because calling it Haringey Social Inclusive Music Theatre sounds a bit awkward and cumbersome for young people. Shed sounds a little furrier and friendlier. So we went along with that. And we get 70 to 100 people, as in kids. And the ratio of practitioners to participants is 1 to 3 because we have a very high degree of our company has special needs. And that's everything from Down syndrome, autism, deafness, spina bifida, cerebral palsy, and so on. So, and in severe cases of cerebral palsy, the ratio might be 1-on-1. So you might have one practitioner to one kid. We set up two different theatre groups. One was called Children's Theatre, one was Youth Theatre. And every summer, we did the world premiere of a new musical put on collaboratively with the kids. Now, a lot of these kids were not just from, disabled backgrounds, special needs backgrounds, but I'd say 1/3 from what I call severely marginalized backgrounds, kids who come from traumatized backgrounds, young criminal offenders, kids with drug problems, with drink problems, domestic violence issues, and so on. And I would say probably 1/3 of the group is what, for a better term, I'd call mainstream. And it was really important to me that we had mainstream kids in because a lot of these kids on the margins and kids with special needs never, ever get the opportunity to work with the mainstream. And kids in the mainstream never get to work with kids out on the margins. And it also, there's another, I didn't want this to also look to the general public who rocked up, that it looks like some kind of curiosity sideshow, a little bit like, oh, it's some kind of circus or freak show. So I thought, no, we'll have 1/3 of the kids will be mainstream, 1/3 will come from seriously disadvantaged backgrounds, and 1/3 from what we call special needs. It was a massive success. And in the end, it ran all year. I didn't do it all year, but we did outreach to schools and we dealt with thousands of kids. As you probably know, because I've told you before, but to me, the best example of how transformational this work is, a mother came to me from the Bangladeshi Muslim community in London, and she said, I have a son, he's 18, he's in and out of gangs and knife fights and police fights. Can you take him under your wing and do something with him? His name is Yamin Chowdhury. And I said, happy to. And he very quickly became an amazing, and I mean amazing, lighting designer, sound technician. He went back to university, did a BA, became a writer, became a drama practitioner, and 1 year ago got the best producing job in London. He's now the artistic director of the Hackney Empire, which is amazing. And he's 30. So let me tell you, unlike sport, which is win-lose and divisive, this is a win-win situation. The kids and youth get involved. cutting a long story short, off the back of that, we did it for the Olympics at Hackney Village. I was then invited by La Trobe University to do it here in Shepparton, where we had a lot of Indigenous kids. Again, a lot of the same socioeconomic problems. We then were asked by Les 20 to do it in the Western suburbs. We then did it in Hong Kong. And then 2 years ago, off the back of that, I was asked, can you do it with older people? We then did it with Choir of Hard Knocks, which is a lot of older homeless people, and with Men Aloud, which was a direct backlash, I think, to the Me Too movement. A lot of men with post-traumatic stress disorder, testicular cancer, and all kinds of issues, like they say, hey, we've got issues as well. Please don't say that all men are okay and it's only women who've got grievances. And I'll tell you, these men, they were fabulous. A lot of them really felt that they were broken and on the scrap heap of society. We did a musical together. So all this was going on. While all this was going on, a bigger project then emerged combining all these, which was Night of Broken Glass. And that was really to commemorate the 80th anniversary of the events of Kristallnacht in Germany, as seen through a lens of an Aboriginal elder named William Cooper, whom I'm ashamed to say as a kid I'd never heard of.
But this was this whole connection to Night of Broken Glass and everything came through your brain.
Absolutely. I thought it would be great to do something to commemorate Kristallnacht, but particularly through the eyes of something that was
Australian. So this whole movement that you've created of inclusiveness for music just blows my mind, because there's music and your successful commercial career is one level, but then to bring this kind of cohesiveness into people who are really on the margins of our society is something amazing to behold.
One of the best aspects for me of Night of Broken Glass, we had 400 people in the show, and we crossed the generation divide. We had kids from 3 and 5 working alongside nonagenarians, people like Uncle Boydie, who is 90. We had a band which was made up of Jews, Muslims, Sikhs, everything under the sun. We had homeless people, we had special needs people, we had undergraduate students. It was absolutely the real definition of what inclusive music theatre should be.
And I went to see it with a mind that was a little bit open but very suspicious, because I saw it advertised and it was like, how the hell do you do a musical about something like Kristallnacht? And who are these people that are doing it? Because it was put on by the Australian Catholic University. And so I went, you know, because I was curious, because I'm very involved in Jewish life. And I was so blown away. My love affair with you began on that night. I went up and spoke to you afterwards. I was just so impressed and continue to be, because what you're doing is, it's not even human. I mean, to these people who you are bringing into the mainstream together with mainstream, and what you were saying just before about not wanting to make it a show or a sympathy thing, but actually inclusion, it just blows my mind. I have total, complete love, respect, honor for you and what you're doing in this, let alone all the terrific commercial stuff.
Oh, no, thank you. I must point out as well, I mean, as fascinating, and it is hugely fascinating, the fact that William Cooper, an elder Indigenous Aboriginal man, made the only recorded private citizens' protest to the German government here in Melbourne against the treatment of the Jews. As wonderful and fascinating as that is, to me, what is even more wonderful is the fact that 80 years on, I can take 400 people from totally disparate backgrounds who have no knowledge of Kristallnacht and no knowledge of William Cooper, and whether they understand what Judaism is or Islam or disability, all they know is that through a joyful creative process called music theatre, suddenly we are all working together in an environment that fosters racial tolerance, racial harmony, creativity, self-esteem, hiring, confidence, which is, to me, this is fantastic. This is genuinely transformational work.
Yes, and you keep the memory of the Holocaust alive in such a beautiful way in this. And I learned things I didn't know about the Bata Shoe Company and how they saved Jews by sending them to India. And it just totally amazing and marvelous. So thank you from the bottom of my heart.
No, great pleasure. It's interesting as well, when I was doing the project, it's, when we talk about a musical per se, there can be a degree of skepticism. Oh, is this going to handle this in a very sensitive and a delicate way? Because let's face it, Kristallnacht is not a light topic
yes.
to have a musical about. Nonetheless, in my experience, working in theatre, music theatre all my life, when you can no longer, we say, when you can no longer speak because the gravity or the heightened emotion of a situation demands it, you sing, you go into music, because you touch on much deeper and more heightened emotions than you can in normal speech. So I have no issue whatsoever, however somber or however weighty a subject is, I have no compunction whatsoever to set it to music.
And you've proved that so true. Mm. But then, and so the stuff you're doing here in Melbourne at the moment too is so different. You put on these wonderful musical evenings with talented people living here in Australia as well, and you're involved in movies, in developing movies and stage shows.
Well, again, we've got a very exciting... This came up of nothing. When I came back here on... at the start of this year in January, which is, 4 weeks ago? I don't know where we are. But I thought, right, it was becoming quite clear I'd only be here for a short time because things are certainly heading back to Europe very soon. Nonetheless, I thought, listen, we're in Melbourne. We know so many wonderful people. We've got to do something. So the first thing is, you mentioned about the Young World Choir. A number of issues which are very close to my heart, and I suppose one of the big ones is water. I'm not going to be one of these people that bang on about there's bushfires and there's climate change. I'm going to use the word water because everyone understands, irrespective of your situation, what it means to have a shortage of water. I don't care what the history of it is. I don't care why it's happened, but it's an issue. It is an issue. And it was made very clear to me, you get water in three ways. You get it from rainfall, you get it from wells, and you get it from the sea. I'm involved with two companies, and this is way out of my remit. One is called Botanical Water, which deals with the plantification of water, which is a game changer. And the other is Seawater Greenhouse. And it's a guy called Charlie Payton, who is a lighting designer, who developed the patent on Varilights in the 70s for bands like Genesis. And he asked himself, I wonder if dealing with light, I can use it to actually feed the world. And it's exactly what he's doing. So water is one of my causes. Racial harmony, obviously, to further elaborate on what we did before with Night of Broken Glass, is another one. And then another issue came up, which we haven't mentioned, which is Macedonia. And in Bitola in Macedonia, there is a football stadium where they propose to do a project which intends to eradicate child poverty by 2025. Well, first of all, that is highly ambitious. But you remember when Live Aid came about, all the goodwill that went on, very little of the money actually reached the very people it was intended for. And a lot of that is politics. What's very good about this Macedonia thing is that they're not looking to reinvent the wheel here, and it's not an administrative process. They're actually talking about the money going for hot meals, for shoes, for very, very practical ways of spending the money to bring about very real change for these kids. So I find myself, okay, I'm aligned to three causes, water, child poverty, and racial harmony, which are very close to my heart. And I find myself with all these different groups around the world who want to participate. One of the great things that happened when I was in Amman, two of the promoters said, Warren, it's great what you're doing, you're playing, and how can we get involved? And so I told them about this Young World Choir. The next day, they send me on WhatsApp, they said, I've got three choirs for you. We have an Egyptian, a Lebanese, and a Jordanian children's choir. They want to be part of this whole experience. So, next Thursday, we're doing a soiree here to launch this Young World Choir idea. It's going to be very private, very intimate, but be the first of many events dotted throughout the world this year, and we will give it as much social media, which I'm a huge ignoramus about, I must say, but as much profile as possible. So we're doing that, which is then followed by something completely different at the track, the Marquee in Toorak Road on February the 27th, with an Israeli singer, Vered Harel. And it is I was asked, do I want to do a season of anything that interests me musically? And I said, yeah, call it Masterpieces, and we'll come up with masterpieces from all over the world in all different generations. So the first one is Masterpieces from in Israel, in Hebrew, in Ladino, in Yiddish, in Russian, that Verity's doing. Straight after that, on the 28th and the 29th, and the 1st of March, a new theatre has just opened here in Albert Park. It's called CAT, Cracked Actors Theatre. It's a beautiful space. It's a bit like Chapel Off Chapel, but it's the Albert Park, proper dedicated theatre. Doing a reinvention of Two Guys and Their Songs, which I did last year, which is pieces I've done with Frank Howson, one of which in particular interests me, because Frank wrote a piece about Elvis. And I know it's become the subject of so much parody and caricature now, because you've got so many lookalikes and karaoke. But this is actually a script with a genuine heart, which really gets under the skin of Elvis. So we're featuring some of that. I'm then doing two masterclasses, also at Cracked Actors Theatre, on music theatre, which will be a weekend thing. And finally, I'm doing another Masterpieces at the Track on March the 14th with Sarah McLean, who is fabulous, and Winston Hillier, and we're doing masterpieces from the 50s through to the 80s, and we're looking at masterpieces, things like Moon River, for example, Natural Woman, Aretha Franklin, and so on like that. So I will not be idle in my stay in Melbourne.
It certainly doesn't sound it. And then on top of that, I know that there's one movie that came out of Night of Broken Glass, that the book that you optioned, that you're also doing as a movie project.
I've got to be very, very careful what I say here.
Okay.
But putting it briefly, one of the things in the profession that I work with, and the piece Reputation was, funnily enough, it was about plagiarism. And I'm going to say something a little bit naughty, so I hope there's not too many lawyers listening. Okay, I'm a nice boy. I'm a nice Jewish boy, so careful. But I'll tell you what happened. A friend of mine, and I can't say who for legal reasons, did a book that came out in America about 20 years ago, did quite well. She then submitted it to a film company, can't say who, but they picked it up. But they then made a film with Nicole Kidman and Sean Penn. Did I say that? When it was called The Interpreter. Did you say
that?
Didn't
hear it, no.
I didn't hear that either. And it was quite a big film. Well, of course, they did this without permission from the writer. Well, subsequently, the writer has a father who has deep pockets, because else you would not be able to contest these issues. A plagiarism fight took case, went through mediation. She won the case, got accreditation, but had to sign an NDA. I'm just making this up. I don't know anything about it, because there's an NDA out of it, a non-disclosure agreement. So nonetheless, a reputation was born out of this idea that to get around some of this stuff, and I don't know who wrote it, and I don't know anything about it, but anyway, it was set in the 1930s, but dealt with plagiarism. Now, the reason I say this, and I've got to be very, very careful here, is because until a piece is actually on and ticket sales on,
gotcha,
it is a real, and I have learnt the hard way many times over in my life, one has to be very, very careful about plagiarism and copyright issues. Everything else I've told you, for example, like the Abai Opera, it's out of copyright. Reputation, happy to discuss, because it's on. Yeah. So as soon as ticket sales are there, that doesn't mean I still won't get sued or plagiarised.
suffice to say, you're involved in quite a number of developments of upcoming shows, both live and movies.
Absolutely. I am. And I'm thrilled about it. Some of them I'm happy to discuss. Some, it's probably more prudent that I don't.
Absolutely,
but
not a problem.
What you're talking about, there is a particular project which is very exciting and looks at a very interesting aspect of the Holocaust and concerns itself with a dramatic stage version of it. It concerns itself with a film version of it. I would say watch this space, and I would hope that 6 months down the track we can talk freely about the matter that we're at the moment being rather coy about.
Absolutely. Now, I'd like to, there's so much to talk about. We don't have time for the music that we planned for this show, even though it's all about music,
right,
because I just want to keep talking to you. So I want to ask you, as you knew that you had a talent at the age of 4.
Do you know what? We used to go here in Melbourne to Footscray. Now, whatever you think about Footscray now, let me tell you, when I was 4 and I went to Footscray, I dreaded it. It stunk of chimneys and factories, and as a kid, it was one of those, are we there yet? Oh, do we have to go to Footscray? Because my grandfather, who stowed away on a boat before the First World War when he was 12 years old from Poland to Birmingham, and he became a tailor in Birmingham. He came over to Australia, and he was a huge classical fan. He had a particular record, and I remember it very well to this day. It's Vladimir Polymu to play Chopin. I heard it when at his place, only at his place. And as soon as I got there, he put it on. and every time subsequently that we went, I'd listen to it. I was so excited. I knew every track sideways and back to front. At that point, that's all I wanted to do. I wanted to be a musician and a composer, like Chopin.
And we're listening to Warren Wills on J-Air 87.8 FM. And just a quick station promo and we're back.
We're always looking for people with an interest in radio, either presenting your own show or being on the technical side. Become a volunteer now. Head to our website at j-air.com.au. Follow the Get Involved link and click on Become a Volunteer Now.
So were you, and we're back with Warren Wills. Warren, so was your grandfather also a musician?
He wasn't a musician. He was actually a very, very keen Chopinist. He just loved classical music. And I remember back in the day, he would listen to 3AR and 3LO, which I'm sure no longer exist. And I remember them very well, and I remember his music very well. I started learning the piano when I was four, and I developed an obsessional, insatiable appetite, so much so I had to literally be physically dragged off the piano stool by my mother to come for dinner and things like that.
Gosh.
By the time I was 10, I'd finished all my grades, and my mum thought, what the hell am I going to do with him? So she took me off on a Saturday to the conservatorium, and I did an audition at the age of 10 for a guy called John McCackie, who subsequently went on to be the Dean of Music at La Trobe. And he said, right, young man, show us what you can do. And I remember this very clearly. I was 10. I sat down at the piano. I thought, well, this is all very exciting, being at the university. And he said, can you improvise for me in B-flat major? I said, oh, yeah. So I did my thing. And he said, right, I'll take him. And every Saturday, my mother would painstakingly take me over to Melbourne Conservatorium, where for 2 or 3 hours I'd be doing composition with John McCackie at the conservatorium. I'd finished my grades. I finished my grades in theory. And it became, for me, what the hell do I do? Then little delights and jewels were dropped before me. When I was about 12, I discovered Stravinsky. When I was about 13, I discovered McCoy Tyner, jazz, Chick Corea, the whole thing, John Coltrane. Then when I was about 16, I did my what was then called HSC, and I did my correspondence at Taylor's College, and I skipped 2 years because I was just so into doing the music thing. I went overseas, and then my life changed when I got into Music Fiesta. And the first thing that happened was I was in London and a director said, listen, Warren, I want you to be musical director in a range of Throppany Opera by Kurt Weill and Bertolt Brecht. And my life changed forever at that point. I thought, my goodness, you mean I don't just have to do music with musicians. I can suddenly work with writers, directors, producers, hair designers, actors, dancers. And I have been blessed since then. I mean, with dancers, to work with people like Veronica Tennant, with writers, to work with people like Snu Wilson, with Margaret Atwood, Woody Allen. In fact, Margaret Atwood, interestingly enough, who is Flavour of the Month because of The Handmaid's Tale and just won the Booker Prize last year, only living woman to win 2 Booker Prizes. We had a piece on just last year in America called The Penelope Ad, which I would love to tell you about because it's a great story.
And I'd actually, we've only got about 4 minutes left.
Right. Very quickly, Margaret Atwood was approached by Penguin Publishers, who said, is there anything in history that you think is wrong that needs addressing? And we will commission it. She said, yes. In Homer's epic tale of the tale of Odysseus, which is covered in the Iliad and the Odyssey, Odysseus' son, Telemachus, hangs all 12 of Penelope's maids on one rope at Piraeus Port, and only 2 lines are afforded to that particular incident out of 2 books totaling 2 million words. And Margaret, being a staunch feminist, said, it's not on. I want to write the Penelope ad, which is the story of Odysseus, but through Penelope's eyes. And she did. The Royal Shakespeare Company then commissioned it as a musical. They commissioned me to compose it. We did it in England. We did it in Canada. And it went on again in America last year.
Warren, I cannot even describe how I feel about what is still yet to come, and you've done so much already. One lifetime is not enough to complete what you've already started, and I'm sure we get many more, but you, no wonder you are so tired and you don't sleep, because there isn't enough time.
Sleep's an optional extra, I figure there's a long time to sleep in about 30 years time when we're no longer here.
Absolutely. And I know that you are very close with your family as well, and just very quickly, your father is aging and in an aged care facility, and you live overseas for 6 months, and your kids
I kind of feel a little bit betwixt and between at the moment. I keep telling people, if only Melbourne was in the south of France, it'd be ideal. But it's such a schlep to get over here. And unfortunately for me, the generation above me are all pretty close to checking out. And of course I feel sad about it, but I need to be very pragmatic about it and think, you know what? Grandchildren keep popping up. What is the song from Lion King? The circle of life. It is. It's revolving doors. I've got to be philosophical.
How did that feel for you when you held your first grandchild?
This is the most extraordinary situation. My mother passed away exactly the same week that I had my first grandchild. My mother passed away here. She passed away here in Melbourne, and my first grandchild was born in London. And I was totally torn, and I made the right decision. I was here with my mother for her final stay, and then I went straight back to see it. But how does it feel? Do you know what? You get all of the goodness with grandkids. You get all the high points and none of the low points that you do. It's all good. There's no minuses. There's zero minuses with grandchildren.
But
they're
the
great.
Kids make up for everything once they give you those grandkids.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
I wish we had another hour. You are just amazing, and I just blessed to call you a friend, and just look forward to everything else that's coming up in your life and sharing it with you.
Lily, it's going to be a fabulous year. And one thing, and I know in Australia we've had some apocalyptic situations going on here, which we know about, they've been very well covered. Being a great optimist and high on life like yourself, I'm actually really looking forward to 2020, and I think so much is going to go on that is going to connect, and it's going to include rather than exclude and divide people. So looking forward to 2020 in a big way.
Absolutely. And actually what you just said is spot on. You can choose to look at all the devastation, or you can choose to look at all the good stuff, and there's always a lot of good stuff around.
Well said. Cheers to that. Oh,
yeah. Thank you so much for being our first guest, 2020, Warren Wills.
Thank you.
Powerful interview. We all interact with lots of people every day and yet know so little about who they really are or what's really important to them. Whether it's family members or people that serve us in a shop or a restaurant, we've no idea what their history is or what they've gone through even an hour before our paths crossed. We all put on a happy face, and we've learned to deal with the world in a way we believe works for us. But does it really? How often have you been angry or hurt or felt like crying, but just kept it all inside? Do you consider that the person handing you your coffee may need an extra smile or kindness? Are you aware how much better you could feel if you were kinder and gentler with everyone in your life? How many parents who seem like lovely, rational human beings turn around and yell and scream at their kids, the people they love the most in the world, when there's no one around to see or hear them? Being high on life is not about presenting a happy face to the world. It's about feeling good about yourself most of the time. It's not about going into deep therapy and discovering why you are the way you are, or the traumas of childhood, or even past relationships. It really can be as simple as deciding to change your attitude right here, right now. Unleash all that love you have inside and be a little kinder to everyone you come across in your day. Smile more, yes, even for no reason, just because it'll come to feel good the more you do it. And most importantly, let those you are the closest to know how much you love them every single day. Change your attitude. Change your life.
מסובך. נמאס לי, מתי זה ייגמר? זה הולך רע. גם ככה אני לא עושה הרבה מין. זה אמור להיות קל. להפסיק עם זה בכלל. עם ספר הוראות שמישהו השאיר
J-Air, 87.8 FM.
Tune in on Tuesday nights at 6 for Road to Recovery with Ben Morley, whose incredible journey of hope, inspiration and self-discovery goes from drug addiction to saving lives to helping families reconnect. It's an hour of powerful radio on J-Air, 87.8 FM, Tuesday nights at